O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul,
good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship here at Redeemer Lutheran Church on this beautiful Sunday morning, November 1st, 2020, All Saints Day. It's why we're wearing white today. It's the symbol of divinity and purity, but also remember that those who have died in the faith are with Jesus. They're wearing white robes gathered around the throne. We'll talk about that in our sermon today, what it means to have 144,000 members of the church, and also what it means to be sealed and marked on our foreheads. Those are mysterious, but they're great, and we're going to go through that today. So again, welcome. Great to have all of you here today. Thank you, Dan and Cheryl. directors of worship, Dan and Cheryl Oy, giving us our wonderful music today. Thank you to Linda Krantz, our reader, Dan Oy, a videographer. I'm sorry, Dan Past, our videographer, and Bob Past, our sound tech. Thank you. Well, we want to thank all of you for some continuing projects that we have ongoing here at Redeemer, funding the Waterfall Project, the renewal of our stained glass windows, and our next big project, of course, will be the live streaming. All important to our church, some of it physical, some of it more administrative and spiritual, but it's helping our ministry to move forward. Thank you so much. And we're excited today to announce the addition of a second service here at Redeemer in the auditorium, our newly renovated auditorium. This will be a family-centered service with Sunday school, more informal, and we're just hoping that God's going to use that to really reach more people for Christ as well. So thanks to all of you. We will continue our in-seat worship throughout the month of November. Please sign up if you'd like to come. Also sign up for our second service as well. And thank you for giving to the regular ministry of our church. You can do that by going onto our website and giving that way, or sending your offering envelope in. Thank you so much. It helps to keep our ministry going here at Redeemer so that we can reach people for Christ. We also have a Saturday morning men's Bible study led by Gordy Engel. It's a Zoom Bible study at 7:30 in the morning. And at 8 p.m. on Monday night, we have a phone prayer conference from 8 to about 8:30 or so, ways that you can connect here at Redeemer Lutheran Church. Also, just wanted to show you briefly the deadline for our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. Will be November 15th, I believe. You can pick one of these up at church. Inside the box will be the set of instructions for what you'd like to do and how to pack the box. Again, these are going all around the world to give kids not only Christmas presents, but in the countries that allow it, they will also be able to share the presentation of the gospel. Well, thank you again. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Jesus, that we are saints, holy ones, not by what we do, but through faith in what Jesus has done for us. Jesus' blood makes us holy, his sacrifice, his death and resurrection. Lift us up, encourage us, but also remind us what the end times will be like and how we need to prepare ourselves for those days. Bless this hour of worship. In your name we pray. Amen. Our service continues with our readings.
The first reading for this morning is from the book of Revelation, chapter 7, verses 1 through 17. After this, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth to prevent any wind from blowing on the land or on the sea or on any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the east, having the seal of the living God. He called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and the sea, "Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God." Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from all the tribes of Israel. From the tribe of Judah, 12,000 were sealed. From the tribe of Reuben, 12,000. From the tribe of Gad, 12,000. From the tribe of Asher, 12,000. From the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. From the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000. From the tribe of Simeon, 12,000. From the tribe of Levi, 12,000. From the tribe of Issachar, 12,000. From the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000. From the tribe of Joseph, 12,000. From the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they, and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel is from the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We turn our hearts to the Lord as we join in our confession and forgiveness. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we gather in the midst of God's creation, before the bounty of his word and table, and in the majesty of his holy presence, we remember and repent of all that separates us from God and from one another. Lord Jesus, you taught us that in your kingdom, blessed are the poor in spirit. Forgive us for our pride. Blessed are those who mourn. Forgive us for not being sorrowful for our sin. Blessed are the meek. Forgive us for being rebellious by nature. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Forgive us for having little desire for your goodness. Blessed are the merciful. Forgive us for being harsh and impatient. Blessed are the pure in heart. Forgive our impure hearts. Blessed are the peacemakers. Forgive us for not seeking reconciliation. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Forgive us for not standing up for you. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Forgive us when we have hidden our voice for you. Fellow sinners, hear the good news. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, that is how large God's faithful love is for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far God has removed us from our sin. Through the power of the Holy Spirit and the cross of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. We receive God's grace and rejoice. Glory to God. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, let us join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Now we worship the Lord with our offerings and tithes and gifts. There's a special place that you can give online as well. So just look for that little tab on the website and you can join us in giving. But we thank you for your prayers, your support, and all that we share together in ministry. Here's a great new song. It was written by Keith Getty and Kristen Getty. And they also wrote the song, In Christ Alone. This song is called In Christ, Our Hope in life and death. And this song came just at the time that we were starting to break into this COVID period, this pandemic. And this song offers us a lot of hope in the time kind of questions, of doubt, of separation and isolation. Christ, our hope in life and death.
Is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end?
The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death.
Can calm the troubled soul.
God is good, God is good.
Where is His grace and goodness known?
In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who stands the waves that bring us nigh, unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death.
Shall we sing?
Christ, He lives, Christ, He lives.
And what reward will heaven bring?
Everlasting life with Him, there we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy. Christ is ours forevermore. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death.
Once again, welcome to Redeemer. We have heard the word of God spoken as well as sung, and now we will hear it proclaimed and preached from Revelation chapter 7. We pray, Lord, we thank You that there is hope in the midst of this tornadic world, our political upheaval, our virus upheaval, so many personal upheavals. Lord, we feel like the devil is overpowering us, but we know that greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. And so help us not to be afraid, but to know that we will have tribulation in this world, but be of good cheer. Jesus has overcome that tribulation. So Jesus, be with us. Give us peace and power. Lord, as your word is proclaimed, help us to hear it and to read it, mark it, inwardly digest it, and to live it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What would you say if I asked you what the most watched film of all time is? In our family, it's no question. It's The Sound of Music. We have watched that movie so many times. My wife, Donna, has every word of every song memorized, and she can sing along with the movie. But when you look at the whole world, the most watched film of all time is the 1939 classic, The Wizard of Oz, where a girl named Dorothy is and her dog Toto is whisked away and whirled away by a tornado, and their house spins up into the sky, and it lands in the land of Oz. When they get there, of course, they meet some wonderful characters, and they go on the road, the Yellow Brick Road, toward the Emerald City to meet the Wizard of Oz, who can help Dorothy get back home. One of my favorite moments of that movie is when Dorothy and Toto, inside the whirling house, crash land in Oz, and Dorothy slowly opens the door of her black and white world and enters the world of Technicolor. From black and white to color. That's one way you can look at our journey of faith through this world. Black and white to color. Black and white, think of it. Think of the house spinning. Think of what's spinning in our society today, the tornado of events, not only Hurricane Zeta zeroing in on our country, but also the hurricane of our election, the tornado of COVID, family tornadoes. There's storms of life. That's the black and white of our life spinning around. There's another black and white, too. We're not living in the color of full knowledge. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians, he said, "Now we see but a poor reflection in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully." We're afraid in this world because we don't know fully why God is allowing things. We don't know what's happening in our life. We still live in the black and white. One day we'll enter the full color of heaven, where Jesus has gone to prepare a place for us in his Father's house. And black and white to color. I want you to think about that as we look at Revelation chapter 7. Because the first part of Revelation 7 really is the black and white of our earthly existence. The second half is the wonderful world of color where we finally are standing before the Lamb on his throne and worshiping him. From black and white to color. Let's take a look. Revelation chapter 7 verses 1 through 4. "After this, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth to prevent any wind from blowing on their land and the sea or on any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the east, having the seal of the living God. He called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and the sea, 'Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of God.' Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from all the tribes of Israel." Interesting interlude here between the sixth and the seventh seal that's being broken, and those represent the advancement of the history of the world from the first coming to the second coming of Jesus. So in Revelation chapter 6, the return of Christ is imminent. A number of seals have been broken. Things are happening in the world, plagues and war and famine. The final tribulations are about to come upon the earth. God has already put horrible signs in the heaven for many people, signs on earth too. The mountains are shaking. People are terrified. In fact, Scripture says that even the kings and the great men, the commanders and the rich and the strong, when they see these signs, they say to the mountains, "Fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand?" That's chapter 6. Think of it. The unbelieving world is terrified. Where are the believers? Many of us today in Christendom believe and are taught that the believers are gone by now. that they've been raptured to heaven, that they won't experience the final tribulation. But I say this, that God teaches and Scripture teaches another picture in chapter 7, not rapture, but being sealed. Let's take a look at that. One angel cries out to the four who are about to start the final tribulation, don't harm the earth until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God. 144,000 were sealed, a symbolic number representing the complete church. Notice here, God does not take his people out. God's people stay, and he puts a seal on them. So the big question this morning is, what's that seal? That's what chapter 7 is about. In the ancient world, documents were folded, they were tied, and then a lump of clay was pressed over the knot. The owner of the document would stamp the hardening clay with his signet ring. That was his special mark. Everybody knew the signet ring of that person belonged to him. And when he marked it into the document, people saw the document, they knew that document belonged to him. And secondly, that clay helped to prevent the wrong people from opening that document. So think about it. What does that mean for us? Ephesians chapter 1, in him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. So that seal on your forehead is the mark of the Holy Spirit in your heart, bringing you to faith in Christ, marking you now, identifying you as a child of God, because you believe the good news that Jesus died. He took the wrath of God upon his own body. He suffered hell. You trust in the work of Jesus, not in your work. And you trust in his death and resurrection. The Holy Spirit marks you, and the Holy Spirit gives you power to be protected in the spiritual warfare that you face every day of your life. So the Holy Spirit gives you the power to be a witness in this world full of terrorized people. And now think of this, and this is the center of All Saints Day. The moment that you are marked with the Holy Spirit by faith, you are a saint. The word saint means a holy one, forgiven by Jesus with the promise of heaven the moment we die, all because you are marked. God sees the mark. He sees the Holy Spirit in you. If you're added to the body of Christ, you are a saint. Now, the day you die, think about it. Are you afraid of that? Sometimes I am tempted to be afraid as well. The Bible says on the day you die, when you have that mark, Jesus will command his angels, and he'll probably say something like this, some type of command, bring him home. He's got the mark. He's one of mine. Or on her deathbed, bring her home. She's mine. She belongs to me. How does God know? Because she's got the mark of the Holy Spirit. It's why we celebrate All Saints Day. These folks are taken home by the angels. Your soul will be translated up to heaven on the day that you die. That's the color we see in the second half of Revelation 7. Think of it. Where are our loved ones who have gone? Revelation 7, 9 and 10. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. This past year here at Redeemer, five of our members have gone on to wear the white robes. Their personal tribulation is over. Mavis Hoopenbecker, Donna Killinan, Orlin Narr, Dorothy Robinson, Daryl Schulte. We'll remember them in a moment in our prayers. Five members of our Redeemer family have come out of their tribulation this past year. They're finally home. They're standing before the throne. Remember what Jesus said? He said, in the world, you will have tribulation. He's not going to take us out. You will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. God's saints are finally signed, sealed, and delivered up to heaven. Think about the people in your life who have gone from this earth. If they were the mark of the Holy Spirit, they gather now around the throne wearing white robes. Their tribulation is over. Meanwhile, here we are on earth struggling in the black and white, stormy world. So beautiful in many ways, but still broken by sin. Don't you try to argue with the Lord. Lord, maybe you could take us right now. Come, Jesus. Come, maybe before the election. Wouldn't that be great? What's going to happen on Tuesday, November 3rd? Maybe you could just take us right now. Lord, aren't you going to take us home before the trouble really starts? Let's talk about that. One day in 1944, Corrie Ten Boom and most of her family were arrested by the Nazis and thrown into concentration camps for hiding and protecting the Jews in their home. The picture on the big screen is Corrie Ten Boom going back to her home years later and showing how they hid the Jews in their home. They hid as many as up to 7 Jews a day in their home. And these Jews then were transferred away to safe countries. Corrie Ten Boom survived the concentration camp. She went on to minister to Christians all over the world, 60 countries, 32 years. She has a great book. It's called The Hiding Place. I highly recommend it. She witnessed the persecution of Christians everywhere she went. 50 years ago, Corrie Ten Boom believed that the tribulation had already begun and that we as saints, holy through Jesus, need to prepare. Listen to what she wrote in 1974. She said, in America, the churches sing, "Let the congregation escape tribulation." But in China and Africa, the tribulation has already begun. Last year alone, more than 200,000 Christians were martyred in Africa. In China, the Christians were told, "Don't worry, before the tribulation comes, you will be translated, raptured." Then came a terrible persecution. Millions of Christians were tortured to death. Later, I heard a bishop from China say, "Sadly, we have failed. We should have made the people strong for persecution rather than telling them Jesus would come first." Tell the people how to be strong in times of persecution, how to stand when the tribulation comes, to stand and not faint. Folks, I'm not telling you this to be afraid. I'm telling you this so you can not be afraid, so that you can be ready to know that God is here with you despite the fact that there's trouble on earth. So the question is, how do we prepare as a church? How do we prepare as a person for the persecution? Listen to this from the very pen of Corrie Ten Boom, who survived great persecution in the concentration camps. Here's what she said. First, we need to feed on the Word of God, digest it, make it a part of our being. This will mean disciplined Bible study each day, as we not only memorize long passages of Scripture, but put the principles to work in our lives. Next, we need to develop a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. We must be filled with the Holy Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit should be the dominant force of every Christian life. Folks, God is leaving us on this earth, not taking us before the worst comes, not because He's punishing us, not because He doesn't love us, but because we have a mission. We are here to comfort those who are terrified, to minister to those terrified by COVID, to those who are just so lonely in isolation. I talked to one of our members just the other day in isolation. She misses church so much. Those who are in quarantine, those who are discouraged by unemployment. Pastor, you're saying, "I feel so weak. How can I personally minister when I am so weak?" My brothers, my sisters, I have an answer for you, because I feel the same way sometimes. Here's the answer. Jesus said it to his disciples when he knew that they were afraid of what would happen in the future. He said, when they arrest you, don't worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Maybe you don't think that you have the strength right now, and you know what? Maybe you don't. What did Jesus say? When the time is needed, you will get it. At that time, the Spirit will be upon you. Church of God, don't be afraid. People of God, don't be afraid. God promises to give you strength. I'm going to close with a little story. When Corrie Ten Boom was a little girl, she went to her father and said, "Daddy, I'm afraid that I'll never be strong enough to be a martyr for Jesus Christ." "Tell me," said the father, "when you take a train trip to Amsterdam, when do I give you the money for the ticket? 3 weeks before?" "No, Daddy. No, you give me the money for the ticket just before we get on the train. That is right, my father said, and so it is with God's strength. Our Father in heaven knows when you will need the strength to be a martyr for Jesus Christ. He will supply all you need just in time. Folks, please don't be afraid. God has marked you. You are sealed. You are a saint. You will be in heaven one day in the full color of the promised land. Until then, get close to Jesus. Enter the Word of God. Minister to those who are terrified. And do that in the name of Jesus. Happy All Saints Day. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Children of the Heavenly Father, safely in His bosom gather, nestling bird nor star in heaven, such a refuge there was given. God His own doth tend and nourish, in His holy courts they flourish. From all evil things He spares them, in His mighty arms He bears them. Neither life nor death shall ever from the Lord His children sever. Unto them His grace He showeth, and their sorrows all He knoweth. Though He giveth or He taketh, God His children ne'er forsaketh. His the loving purpose solely to preserve them pure and holy.
We continue our worship by praying to the Lord. Dear Father in heaven, we thank You that through faith in Jesus Christ, who died, who rose, who took Your wrath upon His own body, who suffered hell for us, that through faith in Christ we are marked with the Holy Spirit. We are saints, sealed, identified by You with the Holy Spirit. You know us. You mark us as Your own. You give us protection in the battles that we will have, not only for ourselves, but as we minister to a terrified world. Lord, remind us that You are not against us. You are for us. We are here to be a difference in this world. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, for the election coming up just 2 days from now, Lord, what a tumultuous time in the history of our country. God, You have this in Your hands. In the chaos and in the way it seems out of control, it's not. We know that. Our lives are not. The country is not. Jesus, we give it all to You. We pray that You would elect those men and women who can serve You best, who can have the best vision for our country. Dear God, we pray, please, that there would be calm in our land and that we, the church, would continue to have the freedom to proclaim Christ. And having that freedom, we would use it. Lord, in Your mercy. Lord, we thank You for those who now wear the robe of victory in Christ, the church triumphant, standing before the throne, worshiping You. We thank You for our five saints in our church who have gone to be with You. From our viewpoint, we're sad because they're gone, but from Your viewpoint and from theirs, they are rejoicing. And so now we remember these beloved saints. Mavis Hoopenbecker. Donna Killinan. Orlin Narr. Dorothy Robinson. Daryl Schulte. We thank You, Jesus, that we will see them again. And for all the saints who are in our heart, who we are thinking about now who have left this earth. We thank you for them as well, Lord. And we ask your mercy upon us as we remain here on earth. Give us strength through the Holy Spirit to minister to the world. All these things we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, in these times when we cannot be together to share the real presence of Jesus in his body and blood, we can still share these comforting words spoken to the disciples in the upper room, and we can remember our Lord and Savior and all his promises to us. The Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'"
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
Receive now the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Oh God, our love.
peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.